Okay, I think we can slowly start. So thank you for joining for this fourth day of this EPW school on the electron photon physics. Today we're going to have the great pleasure of having Professor Roxana Margin talking to us about superconductivity and also Professor Giustino about Polaron. And then after that, we're going to have two hands-on, one on photon-assisted optics, which was presented yesterday, and then on superconductivity. Before we start, I will just mention, because that was asked a few times yesterday, so all the recordings are available, and we've also made the full hands-on session recording available. So you really have all the materials. If you want to go back, do more exercise, you're very welcome to do so. So without further ado, I think we can start with Roxana on superconductors and the Eliasberg theory. Thank you.
Thank you, Samuel. And can you hear me well?
Yeah, perfect, perfect.
And hello, everyone. And thank you for participating for our 4 day of the school. So in this lecture today, I will introduce another capability that is implemented in the EPW code. And this is the anisotropic Migdal-Eliasberg formalism for superconductors. So as we will see in this lecture, this formalism allows one to investigate superconducting properties with anisotropic resolution. So the lecture is structured as follows. I will just give an overview of superconductivity milestones. And then I will briefly describe the BCS theory of superconductivity and mention the Macmillan-Allendine's formula for the critical temperature. And most part of the talk will be dedicated to the Migdal-Eliasberg theory. And in principle, I am going to show how one can derive the anisotropic Migdal-Eliasberg equations that are implemented in the EPW code. Once this is finished, I will just briefly mention another first principle approach to investigate superconducting properties, which is the density functional theory for superconductors. And I will finish the talk with a few examples from calculations in three representative systems. So to start, as probably all of you know, superconducting materials exhibit zero resistance to electrical current when cooled down below a critical temperature. And this property was first observed by Kamerling-Ohms in 1911 in mercury, and the critical temperature in mercury was very low, only 4.2 Kelvin. So besides this vanishing electrical resistance, superconducting materials have another very interesting properties. Any magnetic field is expulsed from the from a superconductor during its transition to the superconducting state. And this is known as Meissner effect. So the discovery of superconductivity has remained or remain more or less a scientific curiosity for many years, until superconductors have started to be used in applications in the late 20th century. And powerful superconducting electromagnets are already critical components in many devices. So they are used in maglev trains. They are also used in MRI and NMR machines. Also the particle accelerators. The particle accelerator in Europe is using superconducting magnets and other advanced technologies, for instance, the early quantum computers. However, as I mentioned before, the superconducting materials used in all these devices work only at extremely low temperature. So the most common alloy made of titanium nitride, niobium titanium, which is the most common material used in superconductor applications, has a critical temperature of about 10 Kelvin. So this restrictions makes them very costly. And in fact, it makes them very costly to maintain and even more costly to extend to other potential applications. So for widespread application, ideally, superconductors should be able to operate at about 77 Kelvin, which is a boiling temperature of liquid nitrogen, and also be able to be easily manufactured into wires. So this is the reason why for the past 40, 50 years or even more, a substantial effort in this area has been devoted to discovering superconductors with increasing critical temperature. So that's maybe a long history, but probably not everybody in this workshop is involved in superconductivity. So now I'm just going to show main breakthroughs that were done in terms of scientific or fundamental scientific research. So by 1980s, there was a strong belief that there is a critical limit for the critical temperature. And the discovery of unconventional or so-called non-phonon-mediated superconductivity by Bednorz and Müller in an oxygen-deficient compound in 1986 was a paradigm-shifting breakthrough. The critical temperature in these compounds, in these oxides, soon exceeded 77 Kelvin, and it was believed that this is going to revolutionize the use of superconducting materials. Unfortunately, the oxides are ceramic materials, and they are not easily manufactured into wires. The next breakthrough was in 2001, when a well-known MgB2 compound that was very commonly found in many experimental labs was demonstrated to be a phonon-mediated superconductor with a record-breaking TC of 39 Kelvin. So this gave hope that other phonon-mediated superconductors may achieve even higher critical temperatures. The next discovery was of another group of unconventional phonon-mediated superconductors. So this is superconductivity in iron nictides in 2008. And this discovery was followed by the discovery of conventional superconductivity in superhydride, sulfur superhydride in 2015. So the superconductivity in this compound reached 200 Kelvin, although it's only under very high pressures of about 155 gigapascals. However, the discovery of superconductivity in the hydrides was a real revolution because it shows that a new physical system can be investigated. And this has culminated with the recently reported discovery of superconductivity in of room temperature superconductivity achieved at 267 gigapascals in a compound of carbon, sulfur, and hydrogen. The current structure of this compound is not known, so this image only shows one of the potential candidates extracted from DFT calculations. So this is in terms of what materials have, or key materials and key classes of materials that have been discovered over the past 110 years in superconductivity research. Now, the first microscopic theory of superconductivity was proposed by Bardeen, Cooper, and Schiffer. And the BCS theory starts from the assumption that there must be some attraction between electrons which can overcome the Coulomb repulsion. And in conventional superconductors, this attraction is brought indirectly by the coupling of electrons with the crystal vibration, so in other words, with phonons. So this picture here just shows the mechanism of electron-phonon electron pair formation in a diagrammatic representation. So what happens basically is that an electron of momentum k moving through the crystal emits a phonon of momentum q and goes into a new state k prime. This phonon is quickly absorbed by another electron of momentum minus k that now goes into a state minus k prime. So effectively what happens is that the two electrons scatter on each other by exchanging a phonon. And in order to achieve this scattering from this initial state k minus k to this final state k prime and minus k prime, these later states must be unoccupied, which is only possible in the vicinity of the Fermi level, the highest occupied electronic state in a metal at zero temperature. One important prediction of the BCS theory is the formation of a superconducting gap, or the appearance of the superconducting gap in the single particle excitation spectrum of a superconductor. So while in a metal, electrons are fermions and must obey Pauli exclusion principle, Cooper pairs exhibit boson-like properties and are able to condensate into the same energy level. So a result of this condensation, a gap forms in the normal state of a metal. And as you can see here, as a result of this formation, gap formation, there is an increased density of states at the lower edge of the gap. And this is because these electrons that initially occupied the states, now just below the Fermi level, they need to be accommodated within the gap. This superconducting gap is temperature dependent and can be obtained by solving the BCS gap equation. So in this equation, delta is the superconducting gap. V labels the pairing potential, the pairing Coulomb potential. And this Enk is the quasi-particle excitation energy, which is written in terms of the eigenvalues in the normal state with respect to the Fermi level, and again, the superconducting gap. And the gap obtained from this equation has a dependence that is shown here. So it's basically its maximum at the zero Kelvin and vanishes at the critical temperature. So you can see as you go above basically the critical temperature, there is no superconducting gap. So now we recover the normal metallic behavior. So effectively, this superconducting gap corresponds to the minimal energy required to break up a Cooper pair. So just to summarize on this, the BCS, even though BCS describes in detail the phenomenology of superconductivity, it is a descriptive theory. So in other words, it's material independent and basically predicts that the gap at zero temperature is related to the critical temperature to this equation. It only works for weak electron phonon coupling. And more importantly, it does not account for the retardation of the electron phonon interaction. So in other words, it treats the interaction between electrons and phonons as instantaneous. And qualitatively, and in reality, the interaction between electrons mediated by phonon is not retarded. So Qualitatively, this can be explained as follows. So let's say that we have an electron that moves through a region of the crystal and attracts the nearly positive ion. As a result of this, the ions respond to the electron by performing a simple harmonic oscillation with the maximum displacement of a weight of the, an oscillation with the phonon characteristic frequency, which can be considered the bifrequency. So for the electrons, it requires a time which is inverse proportional to this Debye frequency to reach its maximum displacement. So in other words, smaller the characteristic phonon frequency or Debye frequency, the longer the retardation that can one can expect. How can we calculate the TC beyond the BCS formula? And you have already seen in the Monday lecture by Professor Gianozzi this equation for the critical temperature. And this is this expression, or an expression for the critical temperature, was first proposed by Macmillan and later refined by Allendine. So this is why many times it is referred as Macmillan Allendine equation. And in this expression, omega log is a characteristic phonon frequency. Lambda is the electron phonon coupling, yeah, which depends on the electron phonon matrix elements. And mu star C is a Coulomb pseudopotential. And this equation has been by far the most used way of estimating superconducting critical temperature. And the reason for this is that it can be easily calculated once you have an electron phonon coupling, and this can be done with quantum espresso, and I believe it can also be done with Abinit. It works reasonably, the equation or the estimation works reasonably well for isotropic superconductors, but as was mentioned on Monday, it still requires dense KNQ meshes to converge lambda, not as dense as for anisotropic properties, but anyway, dense enough. However, all you get here is the critical temperature, so you don't have any information about the nature of the superconducting state. In other words, if it's if you have a multiple band or anisotropic superconductor, and it also approximates the Coulomb interaction to these parameters, parameter mu star. So maybe I'm a bit slow. I will try to go a bit faster. So as I said, the major part of the talk will be dedicated to the Migdal-Eliasberg theory. And this is a many body approach that allows one to investigate superconducting properties with anisotropic resolution. And the theory was formulated in 1960 by Eliasberg, that proposed a generalization of the BCS theory that incorporated the theory of time-dependent electron-phonon interaction formulated by Migdal for the normal state. And to derive and all the relevant quantities that govern the superconducting pairing of a material can be calculated in what is called the Nambu-Gorkovs formalism. So to start this, you need to, the starting point is the pairing electron self-energy that has a similar form with what was shown already in the talk on, second talk on Tuesday by Feliciano. Yeah, so the first term of the self-energy is the van Migdal self-energy. Yeah, so here D is the Dress phonon propagator, G are the interacting Green's function, and lowercase g are the electron phonon matrix elements. And the second term is the basically the GW self-energy. Yeah, so V is the screen Coulomb interaction. One important difference between the equation written here and the equation you already saw on Tuesday is that right now we are writing this expression on the imaginary frequency axis. So this is on the imaginary frequency axis. And this is because, as you will see, the Eliezer equation are more effectively solved on the imaginary frequency axis. Yeah. Another point that I should mention is that the phonon propagator varies on the scale of a characteristic of the Debye frequency. So in other words, it varies for frequencies smaller than, it has important frequency variation for frequencies smaller than the Debye frequency. And while it goes as 1/1 frequency squared for frequency greater than Debye frequency. On the other hand, the Coulomb interaction varies on the scale of the plasma frequency, and this is of the order of 10 electron volts. So we'll come back to this point that we are dealing with two different energy scales when we talk about the electron phonon and the electron-electron contribution. And the third point or second point that I should also note here, that we have these heads above both the Green's function and the self energy. So basically here we are working with a generalized 2x2 matrix. I think the last point on this slide that we, by writing these terms, we have ignored the electron phonon vertex correction. And these neglected terms are of the order of the square root of the electron mass to the ionic mass. So this is called the Migdal's theorem. And this abiotic approximation may fail in systems where the electron and phonon energies are comparable. So in these cases, it is necessary to include higher order terms in the electron self energy for the electron phonon interaction. So this is the same equation that it was on the previous page written diagrammatically. So now how do we proceed from here? So one first approximation is to replace the Dress phonon propagator by its bare phonon propagator. And here this is is defined, or the expression is shown in terms of the spectral representation. So once this is introduced here, we can define a new quantity, which is called the electron phonon coupling strength. Yeah, so doing that, we can rewrite our self-energy expression in terms of the anisotropic electron phonon coupling strength, the non-interacting Green's function, and again, the screened Coulomb interaction. And at this point, the strategy is to impose self-consistency, but in order to do this, we need to find an explicit expression for the interacting Green's function that we can plug in the equation for sigma. So the interacting Green's function obeys the well-known Dyson equation in Matsubara space. So in this case, this G naught is the non-interacting Green's function, which takes the well-known form. So here I'm just writing it in terms of Pauli matrix, just to have a more compact view. And the self energy can be decomposed as a function of three Pauli matrices as a function of three scalar functions. And these scalar functions are the mass renormalization functions. So that's the same as we have seen in the normal state, and they are connected to the electron phonon coupling. Chi is an energy shift. So basically it's just the shift of the Kohn-Sham eigenvalues, and delta nk is the superconducting gap. Yeah, so if we now plug in the expression for the non-interacting Green's function and this expression for the self energy in the Dyson equation, we obtain the following form for the interacting Green's function. And here I'm just writing it in a matrix form. So I did the multiplication with Pauli matrices just so we can easily see the diagonal and off-diagonal terms. So the diagonal elements correspond to normal state Green function. So you see that there is no superconducting gap in this equation. And they basically describe the single particle electronic excitations in the normal state. The off-diagonal elements, on the other hand, are called the anomalous Green functions, and they are labeled as F and K. And they describe Cooper pairs amplitudes in the superconducting state. So these elements become non-zero below the critical temperature, marking the transition to the superconducting state. Yeah, so if we are in a normal metal, these off-diagonal elements are zero. So we are recovering the normal state Green's function. So here it's the equation from the previous slide, but again, here I rewrote it back in terms of Pauli matrices. So the strategy, so now since we have an expression for G, for the Green's function, we can go back to our expression for the self energy. We can plug it in, and then this is our new expression for sigma. As you remember, I said that we need to do to find a way to do self-consistency. So we write back again the way that we decomposed sigma. And now if we equate the scalar coefficients for each Pauli matrix, we can find what is called the anisotropic Migdal-Eliasberg equation. Yeah, so we'll take this first term here from the bottom equation, the coefficient of tau naught, and we equate with the coefficient of tau naught here. So it's going to be this expression times this. The same for this term. Yeah, this chi is going to be equal to this expression times this, and the same for tau 1. So this is why we end up with three equations for a Masure normalization function, the energy shift and delta, and this equation need to be solved self-consistently, because as you can see, both on the left and on the right, we have the same quantity. And went too fast. And this the set of equations will need to be supplemented with an additional equation for the number of electrons, which determines the energy shift. So, so in practice, one can solve. I think the last, sorry, one point that I forgot to mention here. If you look now, we only have the Coulomb contribution entering in this third equation for the superconducting gap, because we don't want to double count Coulomb effects that have already been introduced when estimated the Kohn-Sham eigenvalues in the normal state. So in order to solve this equation, it is common. So one can in principle solve this four equation, but it's more common practice, and that's what currently it is implemented in EPW code, is to make some further approximation and reduce this set to two coupled nonlinear equations for the Masure normalization function and the superconducting gap function delta. So the approximations that allows one to reduce to this two set are the following. We only include the off-diagonal contribution to the Coulomb self energy, and this I already mentioned in the previous slide, and retained in order to avoid the double counting of Coulomb effects. And then we assume that we evaluate all quantities around the Fermi surface. So basically we perform an integral over this Fermi surface. And when we do that, this term vanishes because it's been it's an odd function in the Matsubara frequency. So that's the way why we are reducing from 3 to 2. And since here chi now is 0, this is basically the number of electrons is not changing during the calculation. And another thing that it's assumed here is that the electron density of states is in the vicinity of the Fermi level. It is assumed to be constant. And one point that I will mention in more details on the next slide is that the dynamically screened Coulomb interaction is now embedded into a semi-empirical pseudo-potential new star. So basically, these are the two equations that are implemented in EPW. And in order to obtain a solution for delta, we see that we need to evaluate the electron, basically the anisotropic electron-phonon coupling strength. So as you can imagine, this needs to be done on very dense meshes in order to reach numerical convergence. And you, as you have already learned in this school, this can be done effectively using the EPW code. Now, the Coulomb interaction, you can treat it, or even though the Migdalev-Yashberg theory accounts for both electron-phonon and electron-electron interaction, it is generally approximated to this repulsive, to this semi-empirical parameter. And this parameter is in general assumed to be between 0.1 and 0.2, or is fitted to reproduce the experimental TC. But in fact, we can now estimate new star from first principle using, for instance, Morel-Anderson model. So in this case, the Coulomb pseudo-potential is expressed by in this expression, where mu c is a double Fermi surface average of the screen Coulomb interaction multiplied by the density of states. And this and the screen Coulomb interaction can be calculated, for instance, using the Sternheimer GW code. So now what we are here, we can basically, if we have this sub initio, we can estimate the Coulomb pseudo potential. So now what effectively has happened here is that we replaced the screen Coulomb interaction by a strongly reduced pseudo potential. You remember that I said that we are working with two different energy scales. So in the case of electrons, we have an energy scale of, let's say, 10 electron volts. On the case of phonons, let's say that we have a characteristic phonon frequency of 100 million electron volts. So if you have 10 eV divided by 100 milli electron volts, the log here is going to be 2. Yeah, so this mu star C effectively accounts it's strongly reduced, as I said, and effectively accounts for the Coulomb scattering far from the Fermi surface. I think. I think I had one more point that I wanted to mention here, but yes. By replacing the Coulomb interaction to this parameter, another important thing to mention is the energy range in the summation of the Matsubara frequency effectively can also be reduced from the order of tens of the electron volts to a cutoff frequency of about 1 electron volts. So how do we solve this? Or a few other points that I should mention here is that the coupled nonlinear equations need to be solved self-consistently at each temperature T. And also they will they need to must be evaluated on very dense electron and phonon Q meshes to properly account for anisotropic effects. Then second, as I said, the sum over Matsubara frequency must be truncated. And a typical cutoff of the order of one electron volts should be used, but most of the time in practice, one uses a cutoff of 4 to 10 times the largest frequency in the system, because the the equations are very expensive to be estimated. And in fact, the number of Matsubara frequencies decreases increases with decreasing temperature. Yeah, so the distance between two successive Matsubara points is equal to 2 pi t. So if we have a specific cutoff, lower the temperature, more points will need to be included in this sum. And another thing that we need to keep in mind here that when we, as I said, when I we obtained these equations, we did an integral over the Fermi surface. So the quantities Z and delta are only meaningful for states at or near the Fermi surface. Now, so far I have talked about the anisotropic Migdal-Eliard-Bergonde the imaginary axis. And as I mentioned earlier, this we work on the imaginary frequency axis because it is computationally more efficient to solve them. So this only involves sums over a finite number of Matsubara frequencies, and the equations are adequate to calculate the critical temperature and the superconducting gap. But if we want to extract information about the spectral properties, for instance, the quasi-particle density of states or the singular particle excitation spectrum, then we need the solution on the real axis. So direct evolution of the Migdal-Eliard-Bergonde equation on the real axis is in principle possible, but this is very demanding computational since it involves the evaluation of many principal value integrals. As an alternative is to do an analytic continuation, basically from the solutions that we found on the imaginary axis to solutions on the real axis. And this analytic continuation can be performed using either Padé approximants. This is very light computationally, so it's very fast and very cheap, or an iterative procedure. This is very heavy computationally. And both methods are implemented in EPW. So now let's look at some of this the properties that we can estimate on the on the real axis once we have Z and delta on, in as a function of omega. So here I'm just writing the same expression for the single particle Green's function, but now in the real on the real axis. So the difference is that you can see omega now it's real, it's not imaginary anymore. And the only term missing here is the shift in the energy, but that's very small. So you can add here a chi if you want to have the complete form. So the diagonal the poles of these diagonal components give the elemental excitation of the superconductor. Yeah. So if we again do here the multiplication, or if you remember the previous slide when I wrote the Green's function in a matrix representation, that on the diagonal elements, we had no superconducting gap. Yeah, so the only difference I said here, we also had the chi, the shift in the energy. So the position of this pole can be found by equating the denominator to zero. And this will be given by the following expression. Again, this is, looks very similar to an expression that you saw on Tuesday on Feliciano-Stoke. The only difference is that right now we have this additional term that comes from the superconducting gap. So the real part of ENK represents the quasi-particle energy renormalization by the superconducting pairing, and the imaginary part is the quasi-particle inverse lifetime due to the superconducting pairing. Yeah, and at the Fermi level, if we are now take this equation at the Fermi level, it means that all eigenvalues are equal to EF. So this term is going to disappear. So what we do is basically we identify what is called the leading edge of the superconducting gap. And this is nothing else but the binding energy of the electrons in the Cooper pair. Yeah, so when we solve the equations, and we are going to see this plot a few times today, this is basically the solution for the leading edge of the superconducting gap in MGB2 at different temperatures. Yeah, and this is obtained basically, it's this equation. The other property that I said that we can obtain on the real axis is the superconducting quasi-particle density of states. And this is obtained using the imaginary part of the diagonal element. Yeah, so if we assume that we are in the BCS limit, in that case, Z and K is equal to 1. And if we perform an integral of the energy and then we perform an average of the Fermi surface, one can find this expression. Yeah, and this is just a plot just to see how, for instance, again, you will obtain this a similar plot today in the tutorial. This is the density of state in the superconducting state of MGB2 with respect to the density of states in the normal state. Yeah, so we can see here the two peaks, so which signify that we have a two-gap superconductor. Finally, if you just take the imaginary part of the diagonal element, you can also estimate the spectral function in the superconducting state. And this is an image from Sana's study on calcium C6. So this is the spectral function in the normal state. So here you see that we have one band crossing the Fermi level. I don't remember along which part of the pad this is taken, but once we move to the superconducting state, you see the appearance of the superconducting gap. Yeah, so here, if you look closely, you see that there are no bands crossing the Fermi level. To summarize this part, the Migdal-Eliasberg theory has predictive power, is material dependent, accounts for the retardation of the electron-phonon interaction, works for multiband or anisotropic superconductors, and as I said, it generally approximates the Coulomb interaction through mu star, but this can now be calculated ab initio, and it requires very dense K and Q meshes. As an alternative, and I will only have one slide of this, an alternative first principle method to investigate superconducting properties is density functional theory for superconductors. And in this case, the gap equation has a form that is very similar, is basically similar to the BCS gap. So here, delta is again the superconducting gap, E and K is the quasi-particle excitation energy, this kernel Z accounts for electron-phonon interactions, and this kernel K accounts for both electron-phonon and electron-electron interactions. And as in Migdal-Eliasberg formulas, the electron-phonon matrix elements are estimated or are found in DFT and DFTP. And the kernel K, that the part of the kernel K that accounts for electron-electron interaction approximates the electron-electron interaction using the screen Coulomb interaction through RPA. Yeah, so this method also has predictive power, is material dependent. It doesn't have, as you can see in this form, we don't have a frequency dependence in the equation that is found in the Migdal-Eliasberg equation, but it still accounts for retardation effects through the exchange correlation functionals. It's anisotropic, so it works for multiband and isotropic superconductors. And very importantly, it treats both the electron-phonon and electron-electron interaction on an equal footing. It also requires dense K and Q meshes. And I would say the major drawback is that it requires development of new functionals for electron-electron for interactions. And contrary to ordinary DFT, where are a variety of functionals that a variety of functionals have appeared over the years, as far as I know, only two approximations have been proposed for functionals for the superconducting state, and the latest just appeared in 2020. So now, for the last 10 minutes, so I will leave some time for questions. I will show three representative examples from calculations. So the first example, just because of its, let's say, historical importance, I'm going to briefly discuss magnesium diboride, and we are also going to have this example in the tutorial. So as I remember in the beginning, I mentioned that at the time when MGB2 was discovered, it broke the record of TC for conventional superconductors. But in addition to that, it was also it also have been the first observed, as far as I know, two-gap superconductor. So MGB2 has this hexagonal crystal structure with the boron atoms forming a honeycomb lattice as in graphene and the magnesium ions being stacked in between the boron layers. And here in, I'm showing the band structure and the Fermi surface. So we can see that at the Fermi level, we have two pi bands showing here in green. And this arise from the originate from the boron PZ orbitals and two sigma bands shown here in red. And this originate from in-plane sp2 boron hydrates. So the Fermi surface basically has this two cylindrical or coaxial cylinders. Again, these are related to the sigma bands, and this tubular network, which is related to the pi bonding and antibonding bands. And one important feature, and in fact essential for the superconductivity of MGB2, is the presence of holes at the tops of the bonding sigma bands here. Yeah. So that's basically the essential features of superconductivity in magnesium diboride. Now, if one solves the anisotropic Migdal-Eliasberg equation, it finds two set of gaps at each temperature, and this set of gaps can be associated with the sigma and pi states. And this is the coloring of the Fermi surface with the respective superconducting gap at this highest temperature in this picture. So as you can see here, the critical temperature is defined as the point where the superconducting gap becomes zero. So in this case, we estimated a critical TC of 15 Kelvin, which is larger than the experimental TC. But here, some important effects were not included in this calculation. For example, the unharmonicity, the non-adiabaticity, and also anisotropy in the Coulomb repulsion. The next example that I'm going to discuss is that of superconductivity in hexagonal niobium disulfide. This was also briefly mentioned by Feliciano in his talk on Tuesday. So the Fermi surface of this, or in this work, sorry, I should go one step back. In this work, we investigated the nature of superconducting gap in this compound, and we wanted to establish if it's a single gap or a double or two gap superconductor. Yeah, so the Fermi surface of niobium disulfide consists of three distinct sheets. We have one, the hole like this shape, centered around gamma, that is due to the PZ orbitals of sulfur. Then we have another hole-like cylindrical form, hole-like shape, still around gamma. And this comes from the out-of-plane DZ orbitals of niobium. And then we have this triangular hole-like surface around the K point. And this arises from the niobium in-plane D orbitals. One important thing that we found here is that the electron-phonon coupling is dominated by the unharmonic, low energy unharmonic modes, which are shown here in green and red. Yeah, so I believe about 80% of this, 80 to 90% of this of the coupling comes from these two modes. And when we solved the anisotropic equations, we found in this case, again, two gaps. They overlap with each other, but we can definitely see that the lower gap is due to the Fermi surfaces, the two Fermi surfaces centered around gamma, and the upper gap is due or arises from the Fermi surface around the high symmetry K point. And indeed, if we compare our quasi-particle density of states with experiments shown here in black, we found that the peak at 1 mV can be associated with a superconducting gap around K, while this lower shoulder that we see here at about 0.6 mV can be associated with a superconducting gap centered around gamma. Okay, since I still have, I believe, a few minutes, I will just try to spend 3 or 4 minutes on the last example. And this is not from our study, it's a recent archive paper. And I believe that the first author is one of our participants, if I'm not mistaken. So in the last 5 years, I would say a large number of new high temperature superconductors have been experimentally, have been predicted and experimentally discovered among hydrogen rich compounds. And for example, such predictions have led to a compound of lanthanum and hydrogen, which was found in 2018 to be superconductor, superconducting with, at that time, a record-breaking TC of 260 Kelvin. And the problem with this, all these hydrides, as I mentioned in the beginning, is that they require very high pressures, which makes them basically, they are basically not, cannot be used in any practical application. So scientists have been looking or finding ways to reduce the external pressure required for the hydrides to superconduct. And one strategy is to find a third element that can be included into the voids of a known structure. And this will increase the overall packing of the compound. So in this way, by increasing the internal pressure, it will decrease the external pressure required for superconductivity. So in this archive study, a new compound was predicted in which boron was used as the third element, and And basically boron takes some of this empty space around the hydrogen cage. So this is the Fermi surface depicted with the hydrogen character. And we can see that everywhere on the Fermi surface, we have a predominant hydrogen character. At its lowest is at least 50%. And the same thing, we have that in this compound, the electron-phonon coupling is dominated by the hydrogen modes, which are shown here in blue. So if this compound is synthesized, it has been predicted to be stable at a pressure up to a pressure of or down to a pressure of 40 gigapascal. And the prediction is that it will be a conventional high TC superconductor with a TC of 126 Kelvin at 50 GPa. So this would be an unprecedentedly low pressure for hydrides, where you remember we talk about pressures at 150, 200 gigapascals. And with the TC, which is not room temperature, but it's still way higher than the 77 Kelvin temperature of the boiling temperature of liquid nitrogen. So with this, I think I should finish the talk with a few take-home messages, just to leave some time for questions. So we can say that we can, with the Migdal-Eliasberg theory, we can obtain measurable superconducting properties with anisotropic resolution. And one thing to keep in mind when the solutions of the anisotropic Migdal-Eliasberg equations invariably require a fine sampling of the electron-phonon matrix elements across the Brillouin zone. And here are some of the main references on the Migdal-Eliasberg formulas. I would say paper here, the BCS paper, the Allendine formula, and just some reference on SCFDFT. In fact, there were more references on the page where this was discussed. So thank you, and I think hopefully we'll have bit of time for questions.
Thank you, Roxana. Indeed, I think we can take 2-3 questions and then we will need to go to Faith Channel. Do you want me to read a few or can you, or do you want
I can read a few. I have a question. What is the delta MK plus Q would be the phonon energy that mediates the interaction of the electrons? So this is the delta M and Q is the superconducting gap at an electronic state K plus Q. How to obtain a precise value of the Coulombs of the potential instead of, okay, I think I already discussed this during the talk. So the fun Migdal self-energy is the part. So Feliciano, maybe you can, better
not yeah, sure I guess if the answer is yes. We discussed this on Tuesday. Yes, the Famidal is the counterpart of the GW.
Okay. It's asked if it's a counterpart. Okay, because they are, I didn't understand the question. Yes, is that yes, the counterpart of the GW.
So maybe for that one, because there was a question before. So it's a question about, can you elaborate about the Nabu-Gorkov Green's function? So the 2x2, the fact that it's a 2x2. So maybe why is it 2x2 or something like that? I think that's the question.
I think it was already, I didn't put the slides on the Nabu-Gorkov formalist, but basically it's a 2x2 because the, I don't remember what slide, the diagonal we need to have to show the formation of Cooper pairs. Yeah, and that's basically, that effectively corresponds the Cooper pairs to the off diagonal elements, and this will be the normal elements in a normal state. I could refer if to look at our PRB paper where we give a detail expression of this J in terms of creation and annihilation C operators that shows the appearance of Cooper pairs. So if you, the reference is given here at the end. Yes, in this study. We show the explicit expression that shows the Cooper pairs formation.
Roxana, do you want to take one more question? Maybe the one from Powell, the next one, and then we will move, I think, to Philip.
The literature new story, the Leerbeek equation is very often multiplied by the Heaviside function with a cutoff energy that. I mean, I didn't neglect it. I just didn't put it explicitly. Numerically, we have a sum over the Matsubara frequency that goes to a specific cutoff. So beyond that point, it's effectively zero.
Okay, thank you very much. So I think now we will switch to the second talk from Professor Feliciano Giustino on Polaron. Maybe if you can stop sharing and then Feliciano
okay.
can.
Okay, yep. Sorry.
Thank you very much.